First question, just not about the talk. How many of you from Amsterdam? Nice. How many of you can feel this like shaking floor here? Nice. So you have the same feeling as I have. Okay. So basically, my talk today is I will start with like more of data science because we had like nice discussion about I don't know like how you do A/B testing with Bayesian network and stuff like that. But sometimes you also interested like, if you really build this like nice model, what's going to be happening like afterwards? Because like you can use R, like it's fine, right? But the question like, can you put this R somewhere else, or it's just like the final step of like all your awesomeness that you build it? So it's basically what they're going to have here. A couple of words about myself. I'm like data scientist, one of these like fancy job positions that you call. Like basically, it's just a combination of the guy who knows some statistics and can program things, and in my case, can deploy some stuff as well. Originally, I'm coming from a computer engineering background, so I'm not like statistician that became like data scientist, but another way around. And I do speak at some conferences, so it's my basically a way to give back to community and share some knowledge that I found somewhere on the way, basically. So it's not like that much about open source, but like more like giving talk and stuff like that. I also want to mention a couple of my fellow DevOps guys, like from like Stylight as well. Across the way, they was like helping me with some different things, so it worth noticing like those guys on those slides as well. Yeah, so the company that we are working for and like basically paying for like all the trips for conferences sometimes is Stylight. Stylight is a fashion e-commerce platform. The idea basically is that like there are a couple of different sides. One side is that you have like different products that we aggregate from different shops and platforms, and we like all we do kind of like fancy I don't know like data science inside. And if you're searching for white sneakers, you're gonna get like the best, the coolest white sneakers, the most relevant for you basically. And from another point, we also have like magazine, but not magazine in terms of nice pictures, but also about content. So idea is to build shoppable inspiration or like make style happen, as they're saying. So basically, that's the main point. In terms of size, we kind of like acting on global scale, means that we are live in 15 countries. Headquarters is in Munich, but we also have a smaller office in New York and in London. The interesting things about diversity is that we have like 63% of female in company. So if you're interested about data or about fashion, just swing by. We have like cool stuff around. yeah, so a bit closer to basically the talk and like what we're gonna say. Like one of the definitions of data scientist is like the guy who basically better statistics than like any software engineer, but also kind of like in a different direction. So he's better in software engineering than like any statistician. So sounds something like interesting, but sometimes it could be like or weaknesses from those sides. So you need to be afraid that you're not the guy who doesn't know statistics properly, but he's kind of like know something and also doesn't know engineering. So be afraid of that. yeah, so a bit about the agenda. So I will make like a short introduction why those things are happening and what kind of problems we are facing like in most of the companies. After I will do some, I don't know, software engineering like 101 with something simpler and going like into more advanced stuff. And go through immutable infrastructure, like a concept of that, like what does it mean and like how it could help you. And another hipsterish word is like serverless architecture, something like people starting to say, like hype stuff, stuff like that. Okay, so a couple words about early days of startups and what kind of things are happening there. So basically, when you're like a small startup, like it was the same with Stylight and with many other companies. You don't think that much about how reliable your software. You don't think like how you're gonna scale it afterwards, because maybe afterwards it's not gonna happen to you. Because you need to find kind of like problem. You need to find like business, like clients that gonna cover the things. And after you will see like, okay, now it works. We kind of like still alive. So maybe we can think how the thing's gonna be reliable. Because of that, you end up with like list of huge list of problems. Like, so like some people trying with some not very fancy things. Like, I don't know, like let's start with PHP because like people know PHP and like sounds like a great technology. And after they like, okay, what about business intelligence? Yeah, just put everything like into Excel. And after a couple of days or years later, you end up with Excel of like a couple hundreds of megabytes, and you're like, okay, nice, nicely done. Sometimes you head into the problems that your data science results, that you have some smart data scientists that really know statistics and build a model. But if you want to run it like on a different machine, it's like, not going to work out anymore. Or if you try something, let's say 3 months ago, and after you get like this a new guy who's going to help you out in your data science, and there's no way you basically can reproduce these results. The same goes like for backward compatibility. How many of you use R here? Yeah, some people are here. So the problem sometimes that you use the same package, let's say for NLP stuff, and after you, like 3 months later, you install the same package, and I'm like, okay, I cannot install it anymore. Like, okay, we need to find a way to find the same way, the same things to solve. The same goes for more general problem, like dependency hell. In our company, we use some of Scala projects as well. And if you're gonna try to build those things, it's happening like trying to download all the world and after try to build it somewhere and do like all stuff of crazy things. And sometimes it's not that bad because those dependencies could be solved like in Gradle file and stuff like that, but it still takes some time. So you're not really enjoying this time to get like waiting for all those things. Yeah, and after if you solve it like all of those problems, you get into another one, how to scale those things, because okay, it worked out like on one machine, you even got it running somewhere online, and like your R application is that even providing some useful results, but how to make it bigger, how to make it not one node, but like 5 nodes, or if you moved like from, I don't know, from your own host like under your table to like AWS and stuff like that, it's like another thing. And also, if you get like new people, because everything in your business is going like quite good, how to onboard them? How to explain that somebody can just like have kind of sandbox and basically have the same software as you're using like everywhere? Yeah, it's quite hard. So, but especially new people starting, you're like, okay, there's my code base. We had like a colleague of mine, like Tiago, just started just recently, approximately, and we were showing like some kind of repositories, and after you're like, yeah, but how are you supposed to work with all those things? So sometimes it could be like quite complicated. You're like, okay, here's my code, have fun, like enjoy the stuff. So I will try to explain how you can avoid those things and make it more understandable. Yes, I'm talking a bit speed, but like fast, but it's just like because I want to give you more information about this stuff and have less of those fun moments. Okay, so a bit of software engineering. Some of things that we have all around the places, like most of you already know, I think. We will go like through some of examples how all the things could be useful and maybe some special, I don't know, best practices or like tips and tricks or like just nice stories about that. Of course, some of moments going to be like quite obvious, and you can say like, yeah, Captain Obvious already around, but. It's better to say it like again than have those people who do something like in a crazy way. So better safe than sorry about that. Yeah, so like something that I think most of you already do, and maybe for people who come in like from statistics and they're like, when is a version control? Like, I mean, I'm a really cool guy. You better use it like even if you have like a very small project, even if something like super tiny that you're gonna do for ad hoc things. Trust me, like in a couple of months, if I'm gonna ask you, like, why did you use like this special, I don't know, like feature generation or other stuff, like even your commit message should be or would be for me more helpful because, like, yeah, you can say we have documentation, people are gonna write it properly. Most likely they're gonna say, like, oh, come on, it's just like simple stuff, like, nobody needs that. The same goes, like, for more or less next step. Cover your code, like, at least with some tests that even if you're gonna write the same stuff, you can see that it's already crashing. It's not like, yeah, looks good so far. Yeah, so basically like very simple stuff. For Python, it's not like a long discussion about that. Python war somehow, it's much closer to software engineering than R. So people already know that tests are fine and you can already use like all of those guys like NOS test and PyTest and unit test, whatever you prefer here, there. If you're still like kind of like data scientist guy and you like software engineering, what is that properly? Like I can write R. You can start like with very small stuff, like I don't know, like even like doc tests that like showing what's actually happening like in your Python function would be already helpful for people. And if you start like smaller, you can after always move to some like bigger stuff, like I don't know, integration test or I don't know, if you have, for instance, in our case, some significance calculation, you can already have it like as a bigger scope. Something that people usually quite afraid and in data science world, not everybody is basically aware of them, is TDD. Anybody heard of TDD? yes, some people around here. So TDD means test-driven development. So the first things you basically write the test, and after you write the code for it. Could for some cases sound super complicated because you need to define everything beforehand, and if you change it, like it's already, like all the cycle quite like slow you down in a way. But you can start like super simple, like the same example with dog test. If you're gonna use, for instance, red nose and like nose watch, because we use like nose more or less, more actively basically. If you just run this guy, it works like on different screen, and you see that like your code is like I don't know, like green or red and stuff like that. You already see like every of your iteration and. You don't need like that much of infrastructure to build it like really complicated. Just like start a simple step, and after you will get somewhere with more advanced things. The same goes for R. People say like test for R, like why would you do it? Like no, it's actually not that complicated. So there are basically two things that you need: is like test set and dev tools, and you're already good to start. You will need to add a couple of files that will make your project kind of. Like a package in a way, and after like everything already testable. So even if you're like data scientist and you never gonna push your code into like any kind of production, the guy who gonna develop it like after you, he will be able to basically reuse like similar tests for whatever language of choice they're gonna use it afterwards. So make it friendly for people around you, and especially software engineers, to work with your models, and even have like all those problems that like, yeah, he said like to develop these things, and she did like something else, and like you know all kind of like bad discussion about that. Yeah, what also helpful and like still from the part of Captain Obvious is like code reviews and like pair programming. Sometimes it's helping, especially if you. If you merge, you know, your data scientists, like all those real statisticians with PhD stuff, with engineers, usually they are not tend to work that closely because, like, oh, come on, you do like all this crazy stuff, and after I need to fix it after you, so it's like kind of like a conflict already there. But if you put them like next to each other, it's getting like kind of it's not a friendship yet, but at least that people can talk. So basically, if the guy's saying like, okay, here we're gonna do something super crazy because I've seen this formula like in the last paper, like the guy who actually gonna implement it, everyone's gonna say like, not gonna happen. And you can find something in between. Maybe it's only like, I don't know, like 20% of like your code that you're gonna write, but it's gonna solve like 80% of cases. But it's easier actually to bring it afterwards to production. So yeah, just like sit together with your teams and make it yeah like more understandable. And easier to communicate these things. And after even software engineers, they will get understanding like what is like kind of data problems, and they will also bring like cool ideas there, like maybe something that you never thought like from the point of like data scientist. Yeah, so just try it out. Unfortunately, we still have like many of those problems. Some of them are like different technologies. I don't know, like in our case, you have seen already many of them, and. In order to try it out, it's still quite difficult to set up like environment for, I don't know, like for Julia, set up environment for R, set up environment like with Python, with Kinesis stuff, because we have it somewhere else. So would be nice to solve it somehow, right? The same stuff like that we mentioned, background compatibility and dependency hell. Is there like a way to solve it? Yeah, like at least kind of approach it and find something slightly better. Have you heard about this guy? Yoo-hoo, some people, but not all of them, so I'm gonna tell you some details. So this guy is Docker. I was just like thinking right now that maybe Docker is kind of like very similar to Amsterdam, right? He's like lots of water around, like some containers on top, and like very Amsterdam story. Never heard about that before, but like could be he's like very guy that you can have it like in the city. So internally, it's basically a smart way of doing isolated virtual environments, like in a way, like in simple words. So it's basically you still have your like Linux kernel and I don't know, like a host machine, like in a way. And after like this guy having like many different namespaces in a way. Some of them going like for limitation of I don't know, like of processor space. Some going like the same for disk space and stuff like that. But the idea is that you have some libraries on top of it that will build you lightweight, easy to run and like fast run as well, isolated environment. So basically, it's not like a big virtual machine that you had like back in the day. This guy could be I don't know, like 20 megabytes, depending like of your project. Of course, if you're gonna put there. R with like R Java, it could be like 1 gigabyte as well, but it's a question what you're cooking inside. And I will show some examples like how we reduced the size of those images and made it like much smaller. Why it's still interesting? Because like images, but like what else? We had like virtual environments like for quite a long time. So what is really fancy about that? The nice thing is that all this like Docker stuff is basically very layered. So especially like on this picture, you can see it. You have kind of like base image. Let's say we're using something that's going to use Ubuntu. So basically, this base image is going to be Ubuntu. But after, like, if you're adding something like on top of this Ubuntu, like I don't know, add Emacs because you love this editor. This one is basically like a diff of your original operating system and, in a way, your file system as well. And this has like only difference between like all this like Ubuntu stuff, and the layer is only what you add like on top of it. So some layers could be quite big because you decided to add GDK, for instance. Some of them could be super small because you just create a folder. But the idea is that like all those layers, say, you can basically dump them out. So if you create an image that has like our installation inside, it's quite easy to basically reuse this image somewhere else. And if you already like had some dependencies that you were 100% sure that they are working like while you're developing it, it's quite easy to just reuse it. So remember those like problems? What we have in order to solve them? So I said that like every technology, or we have like many of them. Now every technology will have like their own container. So if you have like a Julia application that you wanna just try it out because like it's super fancy, you don't need to care like how much time gonna spend like a new developer when he's gonna join your team. What he does is just like Docker run and after like name of your image, like everything already basically encapsulated in this like small box. But for you, it doesn't matter because like the guy who is going to try it out, it's just like there. Every package, basically, is also defined like in Dockerfile. Dockerfile is kind of like definition of this like Docker container. So that's the place where you're going to define all of your layers. And those layers are going to be, I don't know, like caches like somewhere like on the side. But the idea is that if you have like some special RCPP version or like some NLP library for R or like for Python and stuff like that, it's always going to be like in this Docker file, and you can just like dump it out. For some cases, you can just like make a big base image. Let's say if you, in our case, we had like a huge Scala application, and it had like lots of dependencies. And even if you have like all those dependencies defined like in our Docker file, like external and stuff like that, it still took some time to basically rebuild it like every time. So when you run it like assembly, it's going to take some time to build it. What we did there, we defined like a base image that already had everything pre-builded, basically. So only your changes that you have on top going to be like compiled in a way, so like no external dependencies. And the same stuff for sandboxing and onboarding. Like everybody can have the same version of production code that you have like running somewhere like on a box. You just like, yeah, Docker run and you're fine. Okay, so a bit to the next one. A couple of examples. So there is a project called R-Base, I think. So for Docker, they have this product, they call it like Docker Hub. And this is basically kind of like repository, if you want to like GitHub, but like for Docker, like in a way. So like on this resource, you can find some of already pre-built projects. For instance, this one is for R. The format of it is like pretty simple. For instance, here they define like environment variable, airbase, and after like version of it, and after you basically define instruction how you're gonna install it. This image is based, I think, on Ubuntu. That's why you have like apt-get and stuff like that. But basically, that's the way that you can define some things like very in a simple way. The same goes like with Python. Like if you have I don't know, your application is connecting to MySQL and Postgres. Usually you need to install some MySQL connector, like Postgres connect some additional libraries that you cannot just install with requirements. So basically it could be the way that you define it in your Docker file, and this Docker already has it like as layers. So you don't need to like think anything about that. But the thing is that you can also inherit those things. So if you use this R-base image, you can afterwards define it as a base image, is R-base, whatever you call it, and like version is latest, basically. And if you use like Shiny, does anybody know about Shiny from R? Yes, some people. So basically, Shiny, I think, is, for those who don't know, that's one of a couple of very good reasons why I use R like more often than I would use it. Because it's a way, basically, to build the UI in like couple of lines. So they have R functions that wrap around the HTML stuff, and in order to build a, I don't know, like a website, or not a website, like a form with like many forms, you're gonna spend like 10 lines, 15 lines, it's like super simple. And we use it like for some internal applications basically. And in this case, I just developed like a Docker file for this like Shiny server. And this guy's basically already reusing like one of base images. So basically you don't need to define anything, it kind of like inherited it already. The only things that you need that specific to your application. So I'm saying that I use like RStudio Shiny server and we get it from there, and after like install like in a way, I can also say like install packages and it's already there. So if I expose the port and add configuration file, like copy expose, like, and you can understand what they do. You already basically have a small application in a matter of, I don't know, like 20, 50 lines or something, and everybody can read and understand what things are happening. And you're already solving those problems with dependencies and all those problems, how to onboard people, how to reuse the same software. You don't need to spend time like, okay, now you go here and download this packet and stuff like that. Yeah, make it simpler. Spend time for something cooler. Yeah, that's part of development, and from another side, like your DevOps is also going to be happy because there is no moment like, eh, it works on my machine, just put it like somewhere, like should be good. So from another side, like in our company, we are trying, we have DevOps people, those like happy faces that you have seen in the beginning of the presentation, but they never like in charge of your application like completely. So those guys are basically traveling around the company and saying like, okay, next 2 weeks are going to be like in your department, like another 2 weeks like in another department, or like 2 months or something. So basically, everything that you build, you can run on your own. So you better understand like what's actually happening there. So there is no more like, okay, ops problems, and they know what's happening there. Yeah. So speaking of images, sometimes images could get like super huge. Like you have GDK and like here we go. Like it's already quite big. You have R. Like R is not that big, but if you use like R Java as well, here we go, GDK as well. So it could escalate really, really fast. So in some of cases, we have images that bigger than like 1 gigabyte, and after if you push it like to Docker Hub, like well, take some time. And after you download it, it's like take some time. Obviously, in the background, you never push like entire gigabyte. Never besides the first time, I hope. Afterwards, they check like your layers. They have like something as I'm not sure it's MD5, but basically hash signature of like every layer, and it does some smart stuff to basically understand that this layer is already there, or like you need something like that. Okay. Yeah. So in order to make it smaller, you can use Alpine Linux. It's a distribution of Linux that like super small, like 5 megabytes base image, and Iron.io has already pre-built that stuff. This example is basically MySQL client. If you use like Ubuntu, it's like 230 megabytes. If you use Alpine, it's like 16 megabytes. So just like keep in mind that you can do it like quite nice. So what about for rolling out? Is there like a way to make it make better, slightly better? Yes. So in our case, this Docker guy is Docker Hub in this case is main guy or in the middle basically. There is also the product from AWS, Elastic Cloud Registry or something like that. Maybe they pronounce it or not, they say it slightly different. But idea is that they do it also for Docker. Even looks like a Docker, basically. But the point is that you can use some of those guys, like Jenkins, for instance, or like CircleCI, like my examples. Yeah, and after you have like your code on Git, as already explained, and you can basically get the configuration running. Yeah, so I wanted to add some nice screenshot from Jenkins, but Jenkins doesn't look nice, so I just like skip this part. Just like have this picture. So idea is that right now we're switching more from Jenkins to like hosted Jenkins in a way that can like be scalable for you automatically. One of those providers is like CircleCI. What is also nice about that you can already define like a YAML file that has like a simple structure. So basically you define your environment where awesome project is coming from and like version. And like when you, I don't know, like when you go like through the test stage, it's gonna build the image basically. For deployment, you can say that every time when, so basically this guy is connecting to GitHub like in the background and they have like some hooks and stuff like that. So every time when somebody's pushing to master, I'm gonna do like Docker login like for this stuff and after push an image because image build is happening like on the stage of test. So basically, every time when the guy or somebody who's bringing some merge like back to master, you're already triggering like automatically stuff with Circle CI. So it's like super handy, and even your R project could be there. So it's like super nice. Afterwards, we have this like deploy stage. So this one is going to be triggered by some deployment with the Amazon platform. At the end of the day, it looks like that. So you can see like in Circle CI what kind of like steps are happening there, and it's understandable, nice. The same goes like for deployment, basically. And it takes like super small for some images. So concept of immutable infrastructure. So I think it was coming from some of startups in Berlin originally, but the idea that you never know what's happening like with your hardware. Like if you deploy something, there could be some leftovers. And some people said, like, you know, like in functional programming, you have like immutable data structures, right? What about if you're going to use something similar for deployment? So like every time when you deploy, just like throw away like all infrastructure, like put in a new one. New one cannot have like any leftovers, right? Because it's a new one by definition. So that's basic idea of that. One of examples like CloudFormation from AWS guys. Anybody from using AWS here? Amazon Web Services? Oh, not that many. Maybe Google? Okay. So idea of CloudFormation, that you can have like a JSON file that basically will define all the infrastructure. So you have some compute nodes, you have like database nodes, but everything is like in a code, basically. So if you have like security group, like the way how you access things, you can define that, I don't know, like enable inbound traffic, and those rules are already kind of like as code. So another name for that is infrastructure as code. So like every time when you change infrastructure, you will have like a git commit that basically does those things. And yeah, this is like a way of defining Elastic Load Balancer, for instance. An idea behind that if you have it as code, that means that you can basically use the same principles for deploying the same stuff. So in our case, we're using like Troposphere. It's like a Python library to generate those like huge JSON files, and using some variables or like like functions and classes, you can define like how you define autoscaling group. And after this guy is going to build this JSON file that you can deploy afterwards. The same goes for like rolling deploys. You can have a special service that like as a part of stack. Like CloudFormation examples, it will init a signal, and if you download an image and you get it like completely, it will send a signal that the image completely ready. So you can add like some health checks there that like retries the stuff, but basically you do not kill the node when it just like looks like starting. You check your health check, and if it's completely ready, you say like, okay, this node is fine. So basically, you can kill like old one. So for this case, you can have 100% of availability and like no problems there. There is a way also to do the same with Terraform. It's like from HashiCorp, yeah. It's basically another way to define those infrastructures like as code. And if you want like for bigger scale, there is a Kubernetes and like Docker Swarm Compose that basically does the same. Fast one about serverless architecture. So idea is you can manage your code and like servers, but what if you can go like one step further and basically have without servers? Turns out that Amazon guys, they have this Lambda service that basically every time when you have event in our case could be you write a file, you do something crazy, you can basically define a function that is going to be computed on those events. Amazon's version of Lambda is Kinesis, and you can basically define for every of those like functions, like a special, or for every of those events, a special function is going to be executed there. Originally, it looks like quite ugly in a way because you cannot see like all the changes. You need basically to upload your code repository every time when you have it. But fortunately for us, there is a project Apex that helping you to deploy it like in simple command. So you don't need to do like any manual inputs. They have like lots of cool features. I'm not gonna go through them because like I'm super short on time. But the idea is that you can define in Python those like handlers or like Lambda functions basically, and afterwards like all of your Lambda is going to be deployed by Apex. And this guy has, if it's like a code, then you can deploy with one command. You can basically add it to CircleCI as well. So now every time when I push changes for my Lambda function, I will like download this Apex and after run it to deploy those things. So this guy is going to do, yeah, like deploy, and all functions going to be updated. So it's like super handy about that. Google has a similar stuff. They called like Google Cloud Functions. They just like started with that, so it's like super alpha. We didn't try it, but if you like on Google stack, could be useful for you. And short things about use cases. So we have this like outlier problem or outlier detection problem. This looks. I actually look at like that. So the thing was that we had a department that was writing data to Kinesis or like Kafka, let's say, and we had some consumers that are going to put some events to, I don't know, like to queue basically that you can process. But we never know if those events are like outliers, something happened wrong there, or like they really have it. So what we did there, we basically defined like one of those functions that's going to, like on every time when you have events there, they're going to do some processing inside, and if it looks strange, the guy basically going to send you that there is like outlier. And yeah, we added like integration to Slack channel, so like every time when somebody screw up something in a different department, you see that like yeah, it's fine. You notice it like before actually people started to feel some pain like around. Yeah, so idea of that also that because a function is hosted totally like on Amazon side, you never need to really. Even define rules for your autoscaling group or like for your Kubernetes and stuff like that. Because every function is going to be executed like on Amazon side and they care about providing enough resources. So if you have like one file, we're going to pay like basically for one function. If we're going to have like 100 millions of files, we're going to pay for all of them. But we never actually have a server that stays somewhere and never gets any loads there. So it's basically quite nice, especially for if you don't know like how much traffic you're going to receive there. In terms of money, it's also quite cheap. So it's quite nice to try out with that. Yeah, it's more or less all about lambdas, and I think I'm already like out almost of time. So I'm happy to answer some of questions. If not, I'm just around the place, so just approach me with any kind of questions. Thank you.
Nice talk. Do you use any service discovery solutions like Rancher, Kubernetes?
Yeah, so the point is that number of our services is not like hundreds or something. It's more like, you know, like tens and stuff like that. It's growing with every day. So we don't have like automatic things. So it's like, in our case, combination of DNS when you can see like when service is going to be from, and also Conv.D. Conv.D is basically utilities that you can connect to I don't know, the console, DynamoDB, and stuff like that, and the guys basically will get configuration from there. So in terms of like discovering where service is coming from, it's like DNS part for us is like right now occasion enough. In terms of getting configuration for services, it's Conv.D plus DynamoDB, but you can also add like console and other guys. So quite fine for that. I mean, if you have like more services, like hundreds and something more, you really need something different. But for our case, it's just like using Bazooka for shooting like birds outside. Cannot hit with that.
Other questions?
Yep.
Have you tried any canary releases on the Lambda functions?
Yeah, we use it like all the time. The thing with Lambda as well that if you have like all your data sources like in Frankfurt, you're gonna have a hard time because like there is no Lambda in Frankfurt yet. They rolled it out last year or something, but we just switched it from Frankfurt to Ireland for now. So yeah, we use like current versions that they're trying to roll out. So like all early things we have there.
No, I mean the. Using a partial of the data on the new version of the codes when you go the next version of the code and some part in the old version of the code and
oh yeah, so I think you can have like a versioning of those things, or you can basically have that not latest function receiving everything, but you can basically manage the things. They also have a gateway API, so they're basically the guy who's going to be in front of your Lambda function, and with that you can do whatever you want. So you can have a proxy, you can drop out like old messages, or you can redirect a different Lambda function. So it could be more scalable for that case. Yeah, there's.
A little bit of a different question, but is there a reason why you chose Amazon Kinesis and Amazon Lambda over? Kafka
yeah.
And Spark streaming?
One reason, like super simple, or maybe two. Like one reason is like we're quite lazy about that, and second, DevOps are not happy to host anything for us. They're like, if there is a hosted solution, just use this one. Like, why would you have your own Kafka cluster? Yeah, like for some cases it's cheaper, but like paying people could be like more expensive, like in a way. So like on our scale and our use cases, I mean, you pay some money, but if you want to move from one to another one, you're like more flexible than like if you have Kafka cluster and one suddenly you want to move to something else, you're not that flexible. So for some cases, especially if your latency like super short and you really need to control those things, Kafka is not going to be answer for you. Kinesis is not going to be answer because Kafka more flexible about that and you can put it much closer. But like for general like startup of our size, I think Kinesis is more flexible because you can spend your core time for actually developing your core features, not like building Kafka cluster because it's super cool. There was somebody on the left.
Well, you spent some time talking about Docker, so I was just wondering if there's a reason why you would choose Docker over VirtualBox or the other way around?
So you're asking Docker against Vagrant, right?
Yeah.
So first of all, like Docker is much smaller, like as like time to run it and also like image size. And also like if you use Mac, for instance, in the background, they're going to use Docker machine or like Vagrant like in like for that. But image itself for deployment is much smaller with Docker. So it doesn't make sense to have like full-blown like virtual machine if you can have just isolation on level of namespaces and like CPU and like hard disk. So for us, like totally enough. Maybe for some of cases, if you have some super greedy images that like stay next to not that powerful ones, it could be that you need more isolation, that like really big isolation could help with VM. But for most of the cases, Docker is like enough of 20%, 80% rule. So basically, you cover like most of your cases without investing that much of time. And there are like lots of things that are already developed by other developers. So if I want to use Elixir, for instance, I just like do Docker run, it's already there. So you can just try it out much easier. Yep. There is two people. Yeah.
I can just try it.
Yeah.
So wait a second. Otherwise, we'll lose it on the video.
Thank you. Thank you for talk.
Yeah.
And my question is, it's really nice, nice talk about tools. But what about data? I mean, speaking of Amazon, we don't really have much of a choice where to store our data. It's usually S3 or just we buy some EBSs and store it there. And what are your thoughts on that? Because it's usually, I think it's more of a bad practice to put data inside of Docker containers because they are mostly about tools and not data itself. But what about data?
Yeah, so as you said, like Docker is about your environment of execution. So it never has like data inside. Even configuration, we never put inside. So the thing is, it depends how fast your data, what is kind of velocity you have there, or variety as well. So for some of things, if it's like real time, we're gonna use like Kinesis or like Kafka in the background. So basically, the only thing that Docker does is just like connect to somewhere when we're getting the data from. If data is like much bigger, we actively use Redshift or like big data warehouse solution. So I don't know. Sometimes I think people are trying to download stuff, but I cannot see why this image of like Docker stuff is gonna have like that much of data. Because if you have something super huge with plain files, most likely you're gonna have some HDFS and like Hadoop like somewhere on site, right? And you're not gonna deploy your Hadoop like in Docker, right? I mean, you could, like some people try it, but like nobody was happy afterwards, like even Hadoop. So it doesn't make much sense. So basically, for computing, you're gonna use compute intensive things. If it's something local, usually it's enough to get this like small portion of data within your Docker environment. So maybe you have like a different example, so we can discuss it like afterwards and see if you have something else there. Yep.
I'm just struggling with AWS the data pipeline.
Yeah.
And what are your thoughts about storing those configurations in your Git repository?
Oh yeah, we had this data pipeline. We tried it like in different departments like 3 times. I think nobody actually got it running properly. So my thought about that is like, good idea, but like implementation somehow didn't work out. Obviously, Amazon guys are like moving quite fast, so maybe if you're gonna check it right now, it looks much better. But we were not lucky enough to get it running. So, and with Amazon, usually there are like different ways to do the same things. So depending like how exactly you're gonna use like data pipeline project, you can just reuse like different things there. Maybe you can discuss it as well, like more in details, and we can come up with something bigger there. Yeah, it's more or less all.
Okay, let's thank you.
Thank you. Again.